Good evening. How are you tonight? Again, may I have the privilege and the pleasure of coming into your home to visit with you for a little while. What would you like to talk about this evening on this anonymous telephone program? What subject is of concern to you? This is a program where we are vitally interested in this most wonderful book, the Bible, this most awesome book of the Bible, this book that has been crafted by God, written by God, and given to us as the supreme law book. The supreme law book. Its laws carry precedence over anything and everything. It is the law of God Himself, of Almighty God Himself. And therefore, it also sets forth many, many laws by which we are to live by, and also prescribes penalties if we don't obey those laws. And indeed, it talks about a time when there will be a trial at which all who stand guilty before God for breaking one of those laws must stand for trial. And because we've all broken that law, this is a scary idea, but it's a true idea. And God has already prescribed the penalty that will be meted out to those who are found guilty, and anyone standing there for trial will be found guilty, and the penalty is eternal damnation. But wonderfully, this law book also sets forth a series of laws that have to do with God Himself, what He must do in order to make provision that a percentage of the peoples of the earth will not end up in hell. And that called for God Himself in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ to take upon Himself the sins of these individuals and be found guilty. He had to stand before God as the judge and be found guilty. And He had to make the payment, which had to be equivalent to these individuals spending an eternity in hell. So it was an enormous penalty. And because He has done this for these individuals, they will not spend eternity in hell. They will be forever with the Lord Jesus Christ in the new heaven and the new earth, which will shortly come to pass. And all of this is spelled out in the Bible. And these awesome, these fantastic, these great ideas which come from the mouth of God are what we are ready to talk about on this program. Even though they're way beyond our understanding, if we had to figure it out, we could never figure it out. But because we have God's statement about these events and these situations, we can know a whole lot about them. Well, this is we have a question here from somebody from India. India, at the beginning of our program, we like to look at least one question, if possible, from somebody who cannot call in. It's not very easy to call in from someplace other than the United States. And it concerns a verse in Psalms, where God is saying in Psalm chapter 31, verse 19, Psalm 31, verse 19, "Oh, how great is thy goodness, which thou hast laid up for them," that is for the true believers. It's the verse before this that our listener is asking about. Verse 18, "Let the lying lips be put to silence, which speak grievous things proudly and contemptuously against the righteous." And the question is, do these have to do with Satan? Is he the one that's in view here? And the reason for the question, of course, is that God does disclose to us in John chapter 8, that lying is something that identifies totally with Satan. He is the father of lies. We read in John 8, verse 44, where Jesus is faulting the Pharisees, the religious leaders of his day, 2,000 years ago, and who were looked upon by the people as being very holy and very God-fearing and so on. But Jesus is eternal God and could look into their hearts, and he knew that it was all a sham. It was all put on because in their hearts they were in rebellion against God. They wanted their kind of a gospel, not the gospel of the Bible. And so Christ said of them, "Ye are of your father the devil." It did not mean that they actually were fathered by the devil, that there was a blood relationship in some way. No, it simply meant that they were spiritually identified with the devil. They were like the devil, and therefore God says, it's like you are sons of the devil. It's like you have been spawned by the devil. And as a matter of fact, Satan did indwell the hearts of many of these men, and so they were very intimately related to him. "Ye are of your father the devil, and the lusts of your father ye will do. He was a murderer from the beginning, and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it." In other words, God is indicating that Satan, who rules over the hearts of unsaved man, is a very, very deceitful individual, a very deceptive ruler. In fact, he comes as an angel of light. He comes like he really has the truth. He comes looking like he is bringing salvation. He comes looking like he wants the very best for those who follow him, and yet it's all a big fat lie, because he's the very essence of destruction. His goal is to destroy. So when we go back to Psalm 31, and it talks about those who lie, they indeed do identify with Satan. One of the characteristics of a true believer is that we find that we are enormously uncomfortable if we tell a lie, even a white lie. That is, a lie that we're telling in order to save someone's feelings or whatever, and yet it's not the truth. The fact is that if we're a child of God, we have an enormous desire to be truthful, in all that we say. And that is because we are following the Lord Jesus Christ. And remember, Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." Even as Satan identifies with lie, so Christ identifies with truth. And that's what's so wonderful about the Bible. It is absolutely true. We don't always like what we read there, but that doesn't change the fact that it is truth. And therefore, it is a foundation upon which to build truthful things. And when we have truth, then we have some security in where we're going in our life, or in our pursuit of happiness as we are looking for that. Well, thank you, India, for that question. That came from India. And now shall we go to our first caller on our telephone lines. Good evening. Welcome to Open Forum.
Hi, my name is Sean Rhodes, and I found out about your show on it's something called Pal Talk.
I'm sorry, that was Sean
Rhodes. is my name.
Oh, yes. And what is your question?
Well, my question is, I have noticed that, and I think I may have read it somewhere, too, in the Bible, that that you can look at the situation when they were in Egypt, the Israelites, when they were slaves in Egypt, they were, in a sense, slaves. That was analogous to them being slaves to sin. And then when God had them put the lamb, the blood on their mantles, that was like, that represents Christ and his blood, which saved them out of that slavery, right? Now, all of them came out of Egypt. So they all got saved out of that slavery, brought out of that slavery. But the thing that happens is only two of them who came out went into the promised land. So is that analogous to what's going on now?
Well,
only
you see,
a few will be saved. You know what I'm saying?
Here, first of all, God did give us many historical events and anecdotes of one kind or another, in which he is illustrating aspects of salvation. Now, when Israel came out of the land of Egypt, a nation of about 2 million people, approximately, we can estimate, they are a picture of those who do become saved. Egypt, there is a picture of being in bondage to sin and to Satan, and enslaved to sin and to Satan, and to go out of Egypt by the hand of God as they did is a picture of what salvation is. It did not mean that they did become saved. We know from reading the whole Bible, even as you have discovered, that very few of them actually did become saved, but they were used of God as a portrait or as a picture or a representation of what salvation is. Now, in our day, that was incidentally was not a picture of coming out of the local congregations. At least I'm not aware in the Bible where God makes that representation. Maybe he does, and I'm not aware of it. There's some things I still don't know. Many things I don't know that may be, that are found in the Bible. God does tell us, of course, to come out of our churches and congregations, although God normally uses the figure of the church being Babylon, because Babylon was ruled over by King Nebuchadnezzar, who was a picture of Satan, even though Egypt also sometimes were used as a picture of Satan's dominion, but not always. But Babylon is always a picture of the kingdom of Satan, and that is what God is utilizing in speaking about the local congregations, and principally because Satan now rules there, and he is called the king of Babylon.
Well, what do you think about the fact that when they were in the wilderness and they were eating the manna every day, which represented the word of God, they got sick of the manna and they wanted to go back to Egypt to eat the garlic and all the other things that they had, you know? That sort of reminds me of someone wanting to go back into sin.
Well, of course, that is what it is. In fact, it's a picture of those who are hearing the word of God. They're eating the manna, but it is, and they're getting some physical nourishment from that, but it is not serving them. In other words, we have people today, all kinds of people who are under the hearing of the word of God, and yet they never do become saved. They love this world, and God has not opened their spiritual eyes, so they eat, or they hear the word of God with their physical ears, but they never do hear it with their spiritual ears. Mm-hmm. And so that's teaching a slightly different aspect of the nature of salvation.
Yeah, that.
Thank you for calling and sharing. And shall we take our next call, please? Good evening. Welcome to Open Forum.
Yes, Mr. Campion.
Yes.
When you was a young boy, what church did you belong to?
Oh, I grew up in a Reformed church, in a Reformed community. The church I belong to originally came out of Holland, it was a church that at the time I really thought was probably as close to truth as any that existed, although as I grew to know the Bible more and more, I began to see the weaknesses there also.
Did they teach predestination?
Oh, yes. The Reformed community, like the Presbyterians, do teach the correct doctrine of predestination. They don't have quite as full an understanding of the nature of salvation as they might have, but they certainly did teach election and predestination correctly.
Okay, I got one more question. If Christ is head of the church, why would he turn the church over to Satan, like you teach?
Well, the fact is that he is the... when we talk about the church, we must bear in mind there's an eternal church that is made up of every true believer. And Christ is the head of that. He is the king that rules over that eternal church. And he will never give that over to Satan. That church is still being built today. Anytime someone becomes a true believer, it has nothing to do directly with the local congregation. But during the period of the church age, the period that God utilized the local congregations to send the gospel out into the world, the true believers, the eternal church, were most of the time members of a local congregation. Not always. It was not a requirement that you be part of a local congregation in order to become saved, but that was encouraged, that you do be a part of a local congregation and be under the guidance of elders and deacons and a pastor and so on. But the local congregation also had many, many, many people in it who were not a part of the eternal church, who were still under the authority of Satan because they had never become saved, even though they looked like, externally, they looked like they had become saved. And that church that is the church that Christ has abandoned. He's no longer present there to apply the word of God so that people can become saved. He has abandoned that to Satan.
Okay, is God a just God?
Oh, God is, that's a question we would never dare ask. He is absolutely just. His integrity is perfect.
Okay, it's kind of a question, but it's all right. If I'm a judge sitting on the bench, a criminal judge, and the clerk of the court brings me 100 cases on January 1st, they're all murderers, and I'm going to have to judge them. Now, if I just don't look at the cases, I just divide the piles 50 in one pile and 50 in the other, then I declare the ones on my right that they go free, and the ones on the left, they get condemned to death. Now, am I just?
Oh, that judge would be committing an enormous violation of justice, but that is not an analogy pointing at all to what God has done. You've raised a very, very important question. You see, here is a human race, and everyone is under the wrath of God. There is none righteous, no, not one, not one. That means every single human being should stand before the judgment throne of God finally and be examined, and they will be found guilty, and God is absolutely obligated that those who are found guilty must receive the sentence of eternal damnation, which is called the second death in the Bible, or the lake of fire. It is to be forever abandoned by God. All right, now, but God gave a percentage of these people. The Father chose a number of these people and gave them to the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, how's that going to work? These people that he gave to the Lord Jesus Christ were under the wrath of God just as well as all the others. And so what has to happen to them? And in order for Christ to take them into heaven, God had to arrange that somehow their penalty, the penalty of their sins, be paid, because a just God demands that that penalty be paid. And so Christ, as God himself, was named by God to be the substitute, the stand-in, to take the punishment, the wrath of God, on behalf of these that he came to save, because God's perfect justice had to be done. There could not be any violation of God's justice. And so every sin of these individuals was laid upon the Lord Jesus. And this is what the cross is all about. He was found guilty. He stood before the judgment throne of God, and he was found guilty of all of these sins. It was an enormous, enormous load of sin. And then he had to bear the penalty. Now, God couldn't say, well, now, you're my son, the Lord Jesus, and therefore I don't think I'm going to punish you the full 9 yards, because I just can't do that. God could never do that, because then his justice would be violated, and God is perfect in his justice. And so God poured out his wrath on the Lord Jesus. Now bear in mind, and this is not clearly understood at all, but when Christ was standing before the throne, by the justice, the bar of God's justice, he stood there not just as someone who took on a human nature. He stood there as God as well as man. He's called in the Bible the Son of God, the Son of Man. And because he was man, he was fully qualified to be a substitute. Because he was God, he was able to bear the enormous, enormous wrath of God that he had to endure on behalf of all these individuals, that had to be equivalent to all of these individuals spending an eternity in hell. After all, God is an infinite God, and only, therefore, was it possible that he could make that payment in the space of the hours of from the time he was in the Garden of Gethsemane crying, Abba, Father, is it possible that this cup might pass from me? And then hanging on the cross, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Until finally he said, it is finished. The penalty had been paid. And so there was no rupture of any kind in the justice of God. It was fully, the penalty was fully paid by, on behalf of these he came to save, by the Lord Jesus Christ. And therefore, now God could say, I forgive you, because sins had already been paid for, whereas those whom Christ had not taken their sins upon himself, they still have to stand before the throne of God and the bar of God's justice and still be found guilty. And that's what the judgment day is all about, that we're coming to very rapidly. Thank you for calling and sharing. And you know, this is probably the most important question we can think of at the moment, namely that we have to keep in mind that salvation is not just a matter of semantics. It's not just a matter of I love you, I have mercy on you, I forgive you. No, it is a very legal situation. It is absolutely a legal situation where a crime has to be paid for, and there's no way of avoiding the full penalty. And until we understand that, we will never understand what happened to Christ when he went to the cross. There are all kinds of people who teach, well, Christ paid for our sins by the physical punishment he received, the nails in his hands and the stripes on his back. No way, no way. That could never make payment equivalent to eternal damnation for those he came to save. Or again, they teach that he paid somehow generically for the sins of the whole world. Well, if that's true, then how come there will be people, hordes of people, standing at the judgment throne on the last day and being found guilty and hearing that awful sentence, "Away to hell you go." And you see, until we understand the legality of all of this, we'll never understand what this salvation is all about. But shall we take our next call, please? Good evening. Welcome to Open Forum.
Yeah, Brother Campy.
Yeah. Hold on just a minute. Hold on. I'll be right back with you right after this message.
All right.
We're continuing with the Open Forum. We have a caller on the line. Go ahead with your call.
Okay, Brother Campion, if you could you tell me the spiritual meaning of some verses in 2 Kings chapter 4?
What was the book?
2 Kings chapter 4.
2 Kings.
Right.
Chapter 4. Could you turn your radio off, please, and that'll help. 2 yes. Kings chapter 4, and what verse?
Verses 38 through 41.
Let's look at that and see if we can see what that means. 38. And Elisha came again to Gilgal, and there was a dearth in the land, and the sons of the prophets were sitting before him, and he said unto his servant, "Set on the great pot, and see there, that is, boil pottage for the sons of the prophets." And one went in out into the field to gather herbs, and found a wild vine, and gathered thereof wild gourds, his lap full. And it came and shred them into the pot of pottage, for they knew them not. So they poured out for the men to eat, and it came to pass, as they were eating of the pottage, that they cried out and said, "O thou man of God, there is death in the pot," and they could not eat thereof. But he said, "Then bring meal," and he cast it into the pot, and he said, "Pour out for the people, that they may eat," and there was no harm in the pot. Now, Elisha, as the prophet that followed Elijah, who was one of the notable prophets of the Old Testament, and God used him to do a series of miracles, or through him God did a series of miracles, that through these miracles that are recorded for us, we can learn something more about salvation plan. Now notice that that they are eating of some wild vegetation that have been put into this pot to make some kind of a soup, and they mixed in some poison with it, so that people are becoming violently ill and headed for death. And so they cry out to Elisha, there's death in the pot. And then Elisha takes a meal of some kind, and he pours that in, and that somehow overcomes the poison, so now they're able to eat, and it's not going to damage them any longer. Now, you are very correct, of course, that this has to have a spiritual meaning. Now, the fact is that the Bible talks about Jesus is the bread of life. That is, we receive spiritual nourishment, we receive spiritual life, as a matter of fact, eternal life, as we listen to the Word of God, which is the Word of the Lord Jesus. He is the Word. And that is where life is, that is where truth is. However, out in this world, there are all kinds of interesting ideas and philosophies and man's idea of what salvation is and so on, and we feed on that spiritually. That is, all kinds of people think that out there someone has the truth that can lead them to eternal life, that can give them the highest happiness that man is seeking. And yet the consequence is that they're putting their trust in these philosophies and gospels and religions that did not come faithfully from the Bible. They're from the minds of men, and men are under the dominion of Satan, who is the father of lies, and so it ends up that all it does is enhance the possibility and the reality. It's not even a possibility, it's the reality that they'll end up in spiritual death, eternal damnation. But what's the remedy? The remedy is that we have to listen to the true gospel, which is typified by this meal, like Christ is the bread of life. He was typified by manna in the Old Testament. When we have the true gospel, it immediately shows where the falsities are in the false gospels and in the philosophies of man, and shows that no, there's no salvation there. That won't do it, and so it neutralizes them. And if we keep listening, God will apply that word to our lives, and he will give us eternal life, so that it is like that now we have spiritual nourishment that indeed will give us the more abundant life. It will give us eternal life and set aside altogether that we're still subject to death, that is the second death, eternal damnation.
Okay, very good. Can I ask you another question?
Yes.
You know them verses in Romans chapter 10 where it says if you believe, you have to believe on the Lord and confess with your mouth and you can become saved? And you had mentioned that word confess means that you have to actually know God to confess him.
Well, in order to confess Christ, we have to become a believer, because we have to be of the same mind with him. In the Bible, the word confess is a word that means to be of the same mind with what you are confessing. And the only way we can be of the same mind is if God has already saved us. And so it is, while when we read this casually, and God carefully wrote this, because this came from the mouth of God. This was not written, first of all, by the Apostle Paul or someone. It was from God himself, and God knew exactly why he said what he said. And so when he carefully wrote these words, let me read that verse in Romans chapter 10, verse 9, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart, well, we stop right there. No one will confess Jesus who is not saved. No one will believe in his heart truly the Lord Jesus, because he is dead in his sins. He is like a dead bone, that is a dried bone. He's absolutely dead. And so the only way someone will believe in his heart, the only way anyone will confess, if God has first saved him. And if they become saved, and they'll also then believe that God has raised him from the dead, and they'll also have the evidence that they have become saved.
Right. Well, that what you said, as far as you have to be of the same mind as Christ.
To confess means to be
in order to confess him. There's a verse that I'd like for you to read in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 11.
1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 11. Let's look at that. 1 Corinthians 2.
I think that goes along with what you're
verse
saying.
Verse 11. For what man knoweth the things of a man, save the spirit of man which is in him? Even so, the things of God knoweth no man but the Spirit of God. That's exactly saying the same thing, using different words. Until the Holy Spirit indwells us, until the Holy Spirit has given us a new resurrected soul that is energized by God himself, we cannot know the things of God. And you know, we see this very dramatically when we try to share the truth of the Bible with a relative or a loved one or a friend or someone that we are very deeply concerned about and who will take the time to listen to us a little bit. And we lay it out very, very simply and very plainly, and yet they go away and you know it hasn't penetrated at all. They just have not understood. And you wonder, well, why haven't they understood? Why? It's so logical. It's so reasonable. It is so biblical. And I said it so plainly. And it appeared like they were understanding. And yet they walk away. And you know from their actions and their words, it did not register. Why? Because they're not spiritually discerned. God has not opened their spiritual eyes. And it really demonstrates emphatically that we have to wait upon God for the salvation of any of our loved ones. We, as agonizing as it may be, to see them live their life and in a way that you know that they don't understand salvation at all, we still have to wait upon God. And in the meanwhile, we can beg God and beseech God and implore God, oh Lord, have mercy on these loved ones.
Well, you said a mouthful. It's the truth. It's very frustrating talking to people. Since I've been listening to you, everything makes sense. It's like you said, it's very plain and simple. I can understand everything perfectly. It finally makes sense, the gospel. I try to show it to other people, and they just cannot see it.
Right.
It just is very frustrating.
But that also helps us, as who have become true believers, to walk very humbly and also to wait upon the Lord and to remain in contact with him as we implore his mercies for our loved ones. All of that is very healthy spiritually for each one of us.
Brother Campion, I must have spoke spoken to at least 100 people and tried to tell them to listen to Family Radio and yourself. And I can tell you right now, not one person has stuck it out. And every one of them has told me that you're off your rocker and that you're under the power of Satan. And not one of them, if just one person would, would come back to me and say, yeah, this guy's really got the truth, and that I could have someone to talk to, that would just be wonderful. But I'm telling you, over 100 people, not one person
I know, but you see, we have to listen to what God says. He says there's a great multitude which no man can number that are being saved. If we know 100 people, we don't know. Remember, this world is approaching 7 billion people. And you don't know 7 billion people. But God is doing his work of saving. And in the meanwhile, he's keeping you and me very humble. And especially if we think that, well, I'm a child of God and I'm going to get somebody else saved. Well, I'll tell you, God will sure quickly disabuse us of that idea, because we won't get anybody saved. God has to do the saving, and he's going to do it in his time. And so he keeps us walking and waiting upon God in a very humble way. But thank you for calling and sharing. And shall we take our next call, please? Good evening. Welcome to Open Forum.
Yes. I had a question about, I've been sharing with this man about, he's very convinced that he's seen a UFO. Actually, when he was younger, that he was in a stadium in North Carolina anyway, and that a UFO had hovered over him. And could you please share, or just let me know where in the Bible where I could share with him on this subject, because he doesn't seem to.
I can't show you anything.
I'll take the call over the air. Thank you.
Yeah, I can't show you anything from the Bible, but we do know that God created this world, He, on the one hand, shows his glory when we look in a microscope or an electronic microscope, or no matter how we look at matter, it always breaks down some more, and all kinds of wonderful things can come out of the slightest particle of matter. Then you turn the microscope around and make a telescope out of it, and you look out in the deep space and you see the billions of galaxies and all the other celestial objects out there. And like the Bible says, the heavens declare the glory of God. And the firmament, the expanse, shows his handiwork. And yet, you know, with all of the, and the Bible indicates that the universe was created on the fourth day of creation. That was about 13,000 years ago. And the Bible teaches in 2 Peter chapter 3, very clearly that at the end the heavens will melt, the heavens will be on fire and be destroyed, and God will create new heavens and a new earth. So there are no people out there. Now, isn't it interesting that mankind has spent billions of dollars going to the moon, trying to collect a little space dust in some way or another, or examining asteroids or particles of that have fallen to this Earth, and they have never, and they've sent space probes all the way to Mars and so on, and Saturn, and they have never found the slightest evidence of life out there, not the slightest evidence. Now, here's what happens with UFOs. Man's minds are very tricky, very deceptive, and if we become obsessed by an idea, and that's very easy to do, We just become obsessed. We think about it and think about it, and it's in our thinking all the time. And then next thing, our eyes are going to play tricks on us, and we're going to see and even hear what we had been thinking about. It's all illusion, of course. It's not true in any way, but no one's going to convince us it's not true. We're going to be absolutely convinced it is true. And you get a few people like this together, and they begin to write articles about this and what they have seen, and that gives you an idea that maybe what or encouragement that what you are thought you saw did have truth, and so no one's going to convince you of anything different. And it's only when we recognize that this earth is where the whole action is. And why is it with all the UFOs that people have seen, and they've even talked to the little green men that tumbled out of a UFO, and why is it that no one has been able to produce a nut or a bolt or any kind of a physical object that identifies with one of these UFOs? That has never happened, because of course it's all existing in the minds of people who are under an illusion. Our minds are very tricky, and that's one of the wonderful things about the Bible. You know, we can get our thinking straightened out more and more as we read the Bible and trust it only. But thank you for calling and sharing. And shall we take our next call, please? Good evening. Welcome to Open Forum.
Brother Camping.
Yes.
Isn't it true that Elijah and others like him and all a bunch of believers always, when they're doing God's will, at the change of this unforeseen doctrine of people not believing in the Messiah and all that stuff in the old church, didn't God take them out of jail and take them from perils and actually set them in front of these church leaders and warn them to turn from their wicked ways, and were actually sent to them in person more than once, actually all throughout the Bible, that were to go to these people that are teaching this doctrine and proclaim this right on their steps?
Well, it is true that God did raise up prophets. Now, bear in mind, the Bible is God's proclamation to you and to me of his gospel program. And when we read about Elijah and his experiences, or Elisha and his experiences, or Moses or whoever, we are to understand that God is telling us more and more what the gospel really is. Now, the command he has given to every true believer is to go into all the world with the gospel. And in other words, the command given to us is not just to go to church leaders or to go to our relatives, but it is to try to get the gospel into the whole world. That's why God raises up a ministry like Family Radio, where we band together in an effort to cover a whole continent with the gospel. But we know that nobody is going to respond positively in the right way to the gospel unless God applies that word to the heart of that individual. We simply are to make sure that somehow they hear the gospel. That is, we try to make the Bible as available as possible, and we teach as best we can the truth of the Bible, but then we have to leave it to God to make the application. We cannot apply it to anybody's heart.
Right, and if the churches have indeed become desolate, that would be a wilderness. And so if John cried in the wilderness, wouldn't it be appropriate to maybe use that kind of a platform too, to maybe, like Paul, to kind of crash in and take these gods from them in the manner of where Elijah tipped over the statues in the temple?
Well, you know, if I would go to a church and say, hey, look, I got a message for you. that I want you to listen to you. What do you think they would tell me? Go, church. Go, get out of here. We wouldn't give you a moment of time to listen. But the fact is, as we bring the gospel to the world, the church leaders, they know what is being said. They are aware when we are saying, for example, that we're at the end of the church age. That is known to all the churches. Believe you me, that is big time information, because that is an enormous threat to them, particularly since it's not coming from an organization that's just a fly-by-night or just identified with some guru out of some strange country somewhere who had been seeing some visions or something. But when it comes from an organization that has a long history of being faithful to the Word of God, they know, they hear, they know what is being taught, but there's no way that any would give a private audience to you to anyone to speak more about that. They're just not about to do that. But our job is really that to the Lord is how he's going to do that. Our job is to recognize we're living in a sinful world. The church is sinful. The world is sinful. And we have to broadcast proclaim the Word of God to as many people as possible in any way that we can do it, trusting that God will make the application to the hearts of those that he wishes to make the application. And that's the way the gospel goes out.
Thank you, Brother Camping. Your ministry has just been, it's been that ray of hope in out there that's in this definite world of darkness going to and fro, and you can see these signs and everybody going to and fro so fast, it just seems like they are definitely being taken for a ride. And one more question. In Revelation, it says something about the believers being of one mind with God and giving our kingdom to the beast. Can you comment on that? Thank you.
Well, the fact is the believers are, the true believers are of one mind with God, because we are energized by God. It is God who works in us to will and to do of his good pleasure. And the Bible is the authority. The Bible is the Word of God. It's the only place that we can go to hear God speak to us. And a true believer has an enormous desire to want to hear what God has to say to me. And so he delights in the Word of God. But thank you for calling and sharing. And shall we take our next call, please? Good evening. Welcome to Open Forum.
Hi. I have a couple questions in Genesis. I was wondering if you could help me with. Can you look at Genesis 3, chapter 1?
Genesis 3, 1. The third chapter, in the first one. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, yea, hath God said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden? Is that the verse?
Yes. My question is, what was the serpent exactly?
Well, the Bible doesn't disclose what the serpent was. We do know that here, at least we can say this much, that here are Adam and Eve, our first parents. They're the only humans in this beautiful, beautiful world which God has created. And Adam has been naming the animals, and they are seeing this animal, then seeing that animal, and then seeing another animal, and of course, as we look at animals, we see how different each one is, and they must have marveled at this, and at what a wonderful, wonderful world this is. And here comes a serpent that must have still been able to walk, because when the curse came upon it, it says you will be in the dust, and so it would be typified by a snake after that. But just what this animal looked like, we really have no idea. But this animal was particularly interesting to Eve because it was the first animal that they came to that actually could speak to them. Imagine, this animal is speaking to her. He's saying, "Yea, hath God said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden." And so obviously she must have been enormously fascinated by this particular animal. Hold on, I'll be right back with you right after this. As we continue the open forum, we do have a caller on the line. Go ahead.
Yeah, I was wondering, could the serpent have been Satan? That's what I was wondering.
Oh, he was. It was Lucifer, as he's called in Isaiah 14. He is a fallen angel who at this time has become rebellious against God. Now, God does not tell us the precise moment that he showed his rebellion, but except that we see him in rebellion right here in this sentence. He's right here, he's questioning the authority of God. Yea, hath God said? He's already questioning authority here, and because the curse came upon him at the same time that it came upon man, as we read in Genesis, later on in Genesis 3, verse 15, the Lord said unto the serpent, "In the sweat of your the seed of the woman would bruise the head of the serpent." And right after that, he indicated his curse was on the woman and on man. The sweat of your brow, you're going to eat your bread, and so on. And so we strongly suspect that this is the moment when Lucifer, or who became Satan, is demonstrating his rebellion against God.
Okay, and I also wanted to ask you, when God asked if he had eaten of the tree, and then he said that the woman gave me, you know, to eat. What was that implying? Why did he? Because he did eat of it. Why did he immediately blame the woman?
Because that is indicating the deceptive character of sin. We always do that. We sin and then we try to blame somebody else. We don't look in our own heart and see the rebellion. We'd like to put the blame on somebody else. It won't wash, of course, because it was Adam's sin. It was he should never have eaten of the fruit just because his wife did.
And the same thing for the woman when she said the serpent beguiled me.
Same thing, you see, and mankind has done that ever since. Ever since. Anyone who's caught in sin or in a crime will first of all try to put the blame on my childhood, on the way my parents brought me up, on my neighbors, or on a brother or sister who mistreated me, or they'll always try to put the blame some other place.
But ultimately responsible to God.
I'm sorry?
But ultimately we're responsible to God.
Oh, absolutely. It's our sin.
Right.
It is absolutely our sin.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you for calling and sharing, and shall we take our next call, please? Good evening. Welcome to Open Forum.
Yes, Mr. Camping. I just want to say, first of all, that I know I'm saved, and I declare that with confidence because I know my Maker. And if a man try to judge me, he has to answer for his sins. So, you know, I just know I'm saved. But I have a question for you, Mr. Camping. First of all, I'm not going to ask you a question. I have called a couple times about this word loose in 1 Corinthians 7, verse 27 and 28, I believe. And like I said, when I look at the word for loose in the concordance, in 3080, it says loosis. From 3089, loosening, which is divorce. And then 3089 says low, loosen,
well,
break,
excuse
destroy.
Me. Excuse me. Now, you've called about this before, and you are desperately trying to find a basis for divorce in the Bible. And so you've turned to a commentary, to a concordance, and found some statement, a man made. It did not come from the Bible. It was made by a man, and you're saying, now, based on that authority, I have reason to believe that I can divorce. And that is foolishness, really, because we have to look deeper into the Word of God. Now, the Bible, if loose meant divorce, then we would have a major contradiction that could not be resolved. Because later on in verse 39, God says that the woman is bound by the law to her husband, and only death can part there, and only when he dies is she free from that marriage, and you can't overcome that as long as you think something teaches. You're going to have contradiction if you think another verse teaches divorce. And as a matter of fact, Jesus laid down the rule in Matthew 19: let what God hath joined together, let not man put asunder. Jesus is eternal God. He there is writing law. He is putting it in the law book. What God hath joined together, let not man put asunder. So when you go to a commentary, concordance, and are trying somehow to make that give you some authority to talk about divorce for marriage, that is going completely contrary to the law of God.
Well, Mr. Camping, you are not listening to me. What I'm saying is, I see this word, these two different words. One word for the first verse, loosen, which is a different word, and the other word, loosen after, is saying that word. Those are two different words, but in the Bible, it makes it one word. Have you studied these words, Mr. Camping? That's my question, because you always say we should look at each word carefully and study that word to make sure that word
is
what
the
it's
word.
Saying.
It is a word that says loose, and you can become loosed from a marriage in different ways. We can say we can become loose from a marriage by divorce. And we, of course, are loosed from a marriage by death. Okay? But now, what is applicable? What is possible? We can't tell from this verse. We cannot tell. If we only had this verse and we didn't have the other passages that I quoted from and others that God has given, we could say, yes, that could include divorce. The word loose could include divorce, the word loose. But the fact is that our conclusion has to be in harmony with everything the Bible teaches. We never can arrive at a conclusion, a correct conclusion, until we test that conclusion by anything else that relates. When we arrive at the fact that divorce could mean, or that loose could mean divorce, then we have to examine that conclusion. And when we read 1 Corinthians 7 verse 39 or Matthew chapter 19 and other passages of a similar nature, we know it cannot mean divorce, because it would not be in harmony with these other verses. And that is a biblical principle we have to follow. This, well, in fact, is the trap that people fall into. They take a verse and study it carefully, word by word, everything that they can learn from that verse and arrive at some conclusions. And they say, well, now I've gotten this right from the Bible. I worked through each one of these words, and I got this conclusion. Well, but it is not an acceptable conclusion until you examine your conclusion in the light of everything else the Bible teaches. And so the study goes on and on and on. And until you find harmony, you have conclusions that are in harmony with anything else you find in the Bible, you have not found truth.
Well, I find harmony. But my question to you still, have you studied each and every one of these words in these verses in the original language, Mr. Camping? Have you?
Not on this particular verse, I have not. But on the other hand, excuse me. Now, we're talking about, we're setting up a straw man. I'm not arguing with you about the fact that this word loose can mean divorce. I'm not arguing about that. That's what you want. That's what you want. That's what you have found that it could mean that. And I'm saying, yes, I can agree with you on that. I'm not in argument with you. Unless you, and maybe it means something else too. I'm not aware of that. But I can allow, yes, it could mean divorce. But that doesn't mean that the verse will allow divorce. You have to look at your conclusion in the light of these other passages. And until you do that, you have not found the truth. This is the way God wrote the Bible. There are all kinds of verses that you can study word by word. And I have done this repeatedly with many verses. You study them word by word and look at some of the conclusions that theologians have come to or Bible teachers have come to, and you say, yep, that's really possible based on this verse alone. But when we examine that conclusion in the light of the rest of what else the Bible teaches about this particular subject, it cannot be that conclusion. That would be it's not harmonious with that. And now the fact the word loose is not limited to divorce. Certainly the word loose includes the fact that that when our spouse dies, we are loosed. There no one can deny that at all. That word definitely means can include the fact that when we die, we are loosed. And that is totally in agreement with the rest of the Bible. But thank you for calling and sharing. And shall we take our next call, please? Good evening. Welcome to Open Forum.
My question is about Satan being referred to as a man.
Yes.
I heard that you gave a reference about this from 1 John and also the book of Isaiah, chapter 14, verse 16.
Yes.
I just wanted to know, are there any other references that God refers to him as a man?
I think there is, but I can't recall right offhand where I read it. The clearest one is in Isaiah chapter 14, because God typified, Isaiah 14 and 1 Thessalonians, or 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, God typified Satan by Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon. And in Isaiah 14, he talks about the king of Babylon, and then without shifting gears at all, that is, without any warning, without any notification that he's really changing the picture a little bit, he is talking about Satan, Lucifer, and then he speaks of him. Is this the man that caused the nations to tremble and so on, this one who wanted to be like God? And so it's very clear why God uses that figure of a man.
Okay, and when the Bible speaks in the book of Revelations, where Satan or there's different beasts coming out of the earth and out of the sea, are those different pictures of Satan coming into the world with different, not so much in different forms, but at different times during
no.
the world? Or?
Well, it for example, in Revelation 13, it talks about a beast coming out of the sea. Let me turn to that a moment. I want to look up something on connection with that. We read, a beast coming out of the sea and the ten horns are crowned. In other words, this is Satan as he comes into the world during the time of great tribulation. The fact that the ten horns are crowned is defining that period of time that the Bible calls great tribulation, that period from the end of the church age until Christ returns. And coming out of the sea, the context shows it is speaking as he rules throughout the world, because notice in verse 7, and it was given unto him to make war with the saints and to overcome them, and power was given him over all kindreds and tongues and nations. It is the fact that, and this is one of the reasons that the world has become so enormously sinful today, Satan is allowed to instigate that sin in the minds of people like he never has been allowed to, and God has withdrawn his hand. He's given them up to sin, so sin magnifies. However, when we get to Revelation 13 verse 11, I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth, and he had two horns like a lamb, and he spoke as a dragon. Now God is talking about Satan, the same Satan, but now he is pictured as someone identified with Christ. He has two horns like a lamb, and he comes as an angel of light, to use the language of 2 Corinthians 11. It's still the same Satan, but it's picturing him as he particularly rules in the local congregations, given the fact that Christ has abandoned them and the Holy Spirit is no longer applying the word there any longer.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Camping.
Thank you for calling and sharing. And shall we take our next call, please? Good evening. Welcome to Open Forum.
Hello, Brother Camping.
Yes.
Hi, how are you?
Very well, thank you.
You're welcome. I have a question. I would like to know some information or maybe some scriptures you can give me. I'm curious about, we are all predestinated, is that correct?
Well, those who are to become saved were chosen by God from before the foundation of the world.
The elect.
And were predestinated to salvation, and they are called the elect. And that does not include everybody in the world, of course.
That's right, the elect.
Yeah.
I wanted to know now if we come under the word of God through hearing his word, is that right?
Yes.
Okay, so if we're predestinated when we're born, are we saved, or do we have to hear the word of God first to become saved?
This is the way it goes. First of all, God chose those who were to become saved long before they had ever been conceived in their mother's womb. In principle, we were all in the loins of Adam, but because we all came from the bloodline of Adam, but we don't actually come into physical existence in any way until we're conceived in our mother's womb. And we're conceived as those who are under the wrath of God. But because we have been elected, at some point God did pay for all of our sins. And that occurred about 2,000 years ago, when Christ went to the cross. At that time, he was laden with every dirty, rotten sin I would ever commit. and was found guilty and had to make payment for them, even as he had to make payment for the sins of each and every human being all the way from the beginning of time until the end of time that God had elected to salvation. Then, at some point in the person who has been elected to salvation, at some point in their life, it could be when they're still a little baby, it could be when they're a young child, it could be when they're a young adult, it could be an hour before they died, like the thief on the cross that was saved just an hour or so before he died. God applies that word to the heart of that individual, and he actually becomes a new creature in Christ. He gets a brand new resurrected soul. And all of that timeline is set up by God himself.
Okay, Mr. Camping, what about the people who cannot hear or see or are handicapped, and when he saves them, if...
Well,
if
the fact is, it is not dependent upon physical hearing. It is not depending upon our brain ability. It is dependent upon God giving that person spiritual ears. Now, here's a little baby. That baby is just born. But that baby has been under the hearing of the word because mama kept the radio on and family radio, and that baby has heard the word of God repeatedly. Can God apply the word of God to that baby's life even though that baby itself knows nothing? And maybe that baby was born deaf. Maybe that baby was born without a mind, or very, very tiny mind, so that it never would mature beyond the mind capacity of a two-year-old. Can God apply that word to the heart of that little baby? The answer is absolutely yes. It is not dependent. Salvation is not at all dependent upon what we know about salvation or our intellectual capacity or anything of that order. It is simply to be under the hearing of the word so that God can make the application, the spiritual application of that word, if he so desires.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. And you see, that gives enormous hope to us, enormous hope. Even if we have a loved one and they're on their deathbed, they're in a coma, and I've been agonizing for their salvation. It is not wrong at all to be reading the scripture. God can still apply that word, if he so desired, to the mind of that individual who is just inches away from death itself, if he so desires. And we will never know. We will never know. We have to leave that to God altogether, whether he ever did so. But thank you for calling and sharing, and shall we take our next call, please? Good evening. Welcome to Open Forum.
Hello, Harold Campion.
Yes.
I just thank the Lord for you right now, and you're just so beautiful and precious. And I have three questions. Why is it the closer we grow with the Lord, the harder it is to live in the world? It just seems it gets more challenging.
I'm sorry, repeat your question. Why is it, what is more challenging?
Well, the closer we grow with the Lord, it seems that life is a little bit more challenging.
Oh, I see. The closer we live to the Lord.
The closer we get to him and grow with him, it seems more challenging here.
Well, I don't know quite how to put that. We live close to him through his word. It doesn't come by just feeling of some kind. Our closeness will develop as we spend time in the word of God, because remember, when we read the Bible, it is God speaking to us. If you have a friend, for example, that, or you may be a loved one, And you're not going to get closer and closer to that person if you never see that person, and you're never able to talk to that person. But as you communicate with each other, and you find commonality in what you're talking about and harmony in what you're talking about, you draw closer and closer. And that's the way it is with our relationship with God. As we read the Bible, knowing that that is God speaking to me, and as we respond in prayer, oh Lord, thank you for that truth. Oh Lord, help me to be more faithful. Oh Lord, and so on and so on. Then that closeness will develop. The place where it'll develop is in the presence of His Word.
Of His Word every day.
Yes, and then of course, as we do, as we grow in the Lord, yes, life becomes more challenging. Of course, that can be understood a lot of different ways. The life is more challenging to remain faithful, or challenging to fall into sin, or just what do we mean by that? Or challenging to take on more ventures, or that can have a whole lot of possibilities. But it certainly means that life can become more fruitful because we are seeing the importance of what life is, and we have a greater and greater desire to share it with others. That's where the challenge is. It is my life telling for the Lord Jesus. There's an old quartet hymn that goes, I want my life to tell for Jesus, that everywhere I go, men may His goodness know. I want to tell my life for Jesus. And that should be the challenge that develops in the life of a true believer.
Right. And my second question is, can worry delay answers to prayers?
You're wanting to which?
Can worries delay the answer to prayers?
Yes.
Can worry?
I still miss something. You're going to be, you have to be
can
patient
with me. Can you hear
me?
Can worry?
Worrying.
Delay answers to a prayer?
Are you talking about worrying? You know, the fact is, the Bible says, don't be anxious. I'm quoting from Philippians chapter 4, verse 6. Please read it for yourself. Don't be anxious. In the King James, it says, don't be, I forget the word. But anyway, it means don't be anxious about anything, but with prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, make your requests known to the Lord, and the peace of God that passeth understanding will keep your heart and mind in Christ Jesus. And that's a real good note to end this program on. And so until our next Open Forum program, may the Lord richly bless you.